All right, everybody. Thank you so much again for coming, and welcome back from lunch. Hope everybody is nice and full and refreshed. Anyway, I would like to now introduce you to our second panel, Unions in the Public Eye. Our moderator for this panel is Professor Cynthia Estlund. Professor Estlund is the Catherine A. Rein Professor of Law at the New York University School of Law. She is a leading scholar of labor and employment law and has written extensively on workplace and governance, workplace governance and democracy. Her recent book, Regoverning the Workplace from Self-Regulation to Co-Regulation, chronicles the current crisis of workplace governance brought about by the decline of collective bargaining and the shortcomings of both regulation and litigation, and charts a potential path out of that crisis. Her current research focuses on comparative perspectives on fundamental labor rights and on China's legal and institutional response to labor unrest. Please join me in welcoming Professor Estlund, who will introduce the other panelists on this panel.
Thank you very much. When I heard the name of the panel that I was assigned to moderate, I was a little skeptical. Unions haven't always been in the public eye, especially public sector unions, in spite of Steve's best efforts to keep them in there. But this turned out to be excellent timing. So I think that one thing that all the panelists may want to say a few words about at least is the recent UAW-VW election and some of the surrounding issues. I'm going to keep my introductions of the panelists really short. You all have the written introductions, and I want to leave more time for discussion. And I'm not going to make any more comments myself right now, but I won't be able to resist joining in the conversation as things go on, I'm sure. So we're going to go in alphabetical order. Steve Greenhouse, as you all know, is not only the labor, he has the labor beat for the New York Times. He's one of the few dedicated labor reporters in the country at this point. His recent book follows up on Steve has paid a lot of attention to the problem that low-wage workers face in the modern economy, and his recent book focuses on that, The Big Squeeze. It's a great introduction to the problems that have been growing in our economy. The only thing I'll add here, given the locale, is that Steve graduated in 1982 from NYU, first in his class. Never practiced law a day in his life. Students don't take too much from that.
I decided to take a low-wage job instead.
All right, so next we'll hear from Randy Johnson, who's the Senior Vice President for Labor, Immigration, and Employee Benefits for the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. He is a leading advocate for immigration reform on the employer side of things. He worked in the past both in Congress on the staff of the House Committee on Education and the Workforce, and before that with the U.S. Department of Labor, and apparently started out his career on the union side. I just learned that. So I guess he went running from that.
You work with about corporate labor.
So then finally we'll hear from Tom Kochan. Tom is the George Maverick Bunker Professor of Management at the Sloan School of Management at MIT, and he is one of the leading industrial relations scholars in the country. He's a leading voice for the notion that collective bargaining can be a vehicle of cooperation and pursuit of mutual gains. Tom, I'm fortunate that Tom has shared my recent interest in China, so we've had some intersections over that. So each of the panelists is going to take about 10 minutes to give their view of things, and then we'll engage in a little bit more conversation within the panel before opening it up for discussion. So take it away, Steve.
I'm going to stand up, not because I have a big ego, but just because I find people are not as likely to fall asleep when you're talking standing up as when you're sitting down. And it's less likely I'll knock my tea over with my hands. So I'm really honored to be here. The survey has really put together a very, very impressive conference, even though they invited me. And this is a terrific panel. You know, I know Cindy. She's a terrific scholar. Randy Johnson is perhaps the nation's foremost business spokesman on labor employment issues. I tell everyone, Randy, I quote you more than anyone else. Period. You know, I've quoted you more than anyone else. Sometimes my editors say, stop quoting Randy Johnson. And Tom Kochan is really one of the foremost, you know, by far one of the foremost labor experts in the nation, and a graduate of the great University of Wisconsin. So the name of this panel is Unions in the Public Eye. Well, here is one well-known public official and how she views unions. This is from today's USA Today. Dateline, Greenville, South Carolina. South Carolina loves its manufacturing jobs from BMW, Michelin, and Boeing, and wants more. But Governor Nikki Haley says they're not welcome if they're bringing a unionized workforce. Quote, it's not something we want to see happen, she said after an appearance at an automotive conference downtown. We discourage any companies that have unions from wanting to come to South Carolina because we don't want to taint the water. The governor urged more than 200 people at the conference to keep up their guard against unions. Quote, they're coming into South Carolina. They're trying, Haley warned. We're hearing it. The good news is it's not working. Then she said, you've heard me many times. I wear heels. It's not for a fashion statement. It's because we're kicking them every day and we'll continue to kick them. So that's one way unions are in the public eye. In contradistinction, I'll use a pretentious word. So another way unions have been in the public eye is this fast food forward campaign, these fast food workers demanding $15 an hour. And this is not a formal union effort, you know, although it's underwritten in large part by the SEIU, but it really is a group of workers. It started out here in New York City in November of 2012, where maybe 100 workers walked out for a day. And I think a lot of people thought this was going to amount to just a hill of beans and not much. So lo and behold, 8-10 months later, workers walked out in about 80-100 cities, thousands and thousands of fast food workers. They would love a union. They don't know how they're going to get there. They would love $15 an hour. It's not clear how they get there, but it shows that many workers, especially low-wage workers, think something is badly broken in the economy, and they're looking for a way to turn things around. And one thing they're looking to is unions, but as many of them told me, it's very hard to persuade a majority of people in a workplace to unionize. Yes, they can easily win a unionization election in 10 or 20 or 30 fast food restaurants. They realize that, but then to get a contract might take forever and then some. Okay, Cindy wanted me to talk a little about Chattanooga and Volkswagen. I was there last week, last Friday night around 10:15 p.m. in the Volkswagen plant. Retired judge announced the results. The union lost by 86 votes, 712 to 626. Bob King, the UAW president, was totally shocked. The union really thought it was going to win. And I'd interviewed about a dozen pro-union workers in the plant and about four or five anti-union workers. And the pro-union workers, this is a workforce in the South, in a region of the South and Eastern Tennessee that probably voted 65% for Romney, 35% for Obama. The union acknowledged that a majority of the workers in the plant were Republican, yet the union was confident that the workers would back the UAW, partly because VW, unlike most American companies, was not only neutral, but in ways was tacitly, quietly backing the unionization effort because it wanted to set up a works council. So a lot of the workers I interviewed said, we think it would be good to have a union. It might increase job security. It might nudge up our wages a bit. But mostly, we want a voice through a works council. And on the other side, the anti-union workers said, basically, unions, what verb should I use? I'd say suck. Forgive me. You're not supposed to talk like that. They believe that UAW, hurt the automakers in Detroit. A lot of them have friends and relatives who've been in unions, and a lot of unions do not do a great job representing workers. And then, of course, Grover Norquist, the anti-tax crusader, his group put up 13 billboards saying, look what the UAW has done to Detroit. They had a website saying the UAW is this, or they also put up a billboard saying, United Auto Workers, crossing out auto, saying Obama workers. So I said United Obama workers, saying, why would you vote for a progressive union that is out of line with what we believe in Tennessee? And then Senator Corker, the former mayor of Chattanooga, said on the first day of the 3 days of voting that he has been assured by sources within Volkswagen that if the workers vote down a union, then a second production line would come in, probably adding another 1,000, 1,500 jobs, which would certainly increase job security for people already at the plant and probably mean jobs for their friends and neighbors and sons and daughters. And you all know what happened there. And we'll talk about this later in the Q&A period. But clearly, labor's been in the public eye. And clearly, that was a very, very embarrassing, bitter, stinging Detroit Free Press called it a devastating defeat for labor. After the vote, I spoke to Sean McElinden, who's the director of research for the Center for Automotive Policy Research, and I asked him, Sean, is this the death knell for efforts to seek to organize manufacturing plants in the South? And he said, and I think in many ways it is, he said no, and he said to me something very much like Randy Johnson often says to me. He said, there will certainly be some companies that treat their workers so badly that they deserve a union. And he used the same line that I've heard you say, Randy, that some companies get the union they deserve. I was in Houston at the AFL-CIO winter meeting this week. I was talking to Stuart Applebaum, who heads the retail wholesale department store union here in New York. And he said, it's ridiculous to say that unions cannot win in the South. He told me that in the past year, they won a unionization election at a poultry plant in Alabama, 1,200 workers, and another one for 550 workers in Alabama. So where else have unions been in the public eye? Clearly in Wisconsin. And I have a story coming out over the next week about what's happening with unions in Wisconsin. And Wisconsin's really put the whole issue of public sector unions on the map in a way that the labor movement never wanted. And shortly after Walker was elected, he said, we can no longer live in a society where the public employees are the haves and taxpayers who foot the bills are the have-nots. The bottom line is that we're going to look at every legal means we have to try to put that balance more on the side of taxpayers. And I imagine some people in this room vehemently disagree with what Walker said. But clearly, many people in the state of Wisconsin, certainly the majority of people in the state legislature, agreed with him, and they enacted these, this landmark bill that really rolled back the ability of unions to bargain collectively. And one of the things that struck me is, I was in Wisconsin during the confrontation commotion there, and a lot of people I spoke to there. Were really jealous, envious, resentful of the good health benefits and the good pension benefits that a lot of public sector workers had. And once upon a time, private sector workers generally had better pensions and benefits than public sector workers, but there really has been an erosion of what many private sector workers have as the labor movement has declined. So it's turned out that the public sector labor movement, public sector unions have better fringe benefits. I remember discussing this with my mother, who grew up during the Depression, and she said, when I was young, all these people would say, look what these union people have. They have great wages, they have great pensions, they have great health care. I want that too, and they strive to get that. And she was struck that now kind of the things have flipped and people say, oh, those union people have it good, we should bring them down, because they have better than what we want. Besides, we're taxpayers, we don't want to pay for it. So they're really, in Wisconsin, I think really showed, and at Volkswagen also showed, that unions have a very serious public relations problem. Having said that, unions got some good news last year. Pew Research did a poll that showed that views of unions and business have rebounded handsomely, rebounded nicely since the Great Recession. So now Americans by 51% to 42% hold a favorable view of unions. And one thing that's most intriguing to me is the group that's most enthusiastic, the age group that's most enthusiastic about unions are Americans age 18 to 29. And they favor unions, 61% have a favorable view of unions, 29% have an unfavorable view. And I think, you know, that's surprising for many reasons, partly because I think a lot of young people know very little about unions. But I think they're feeling so, such discomfort economically, the job market's so bad, wages, even for college graduates, are down after inflation from where they were 5-10 years ago. So like the fast food workers, they're like reaching out saying something is very broken in the American economy, we need help. Even though they don't know much about unions, they figure, well, there's someone who, there's some institution out there that might help them. So last September, I was out in Los Angeles at the once every 4 year convention of the AFL-CIO. And you know, that in many ways, in my view, is a historical convention because more than any other time I've ever seen, the labor movement really stepped up and acknowledged it is in crisis. I think for years and years they've denied it. They kind of, there was very little sense of urgency. And you know, Richard Trumka, president of the AFL-CIO, said the crisis for labor has deepened. It's at a point where we really must do something differently. We really have to experiment. He said, in talking at that convention, at the end of the day, it's on us to build a movement not for the 99%, but of the 99%, not just the 11% we are right now. And in Houston, at their winter meeting, in many ways, you know, Richard Trumka, some union presidents, were kind of saying all the right things you would expect them to say to try to win back public support, to revive the labor movement. In Mr. Trumka's news briefings, whenever he got in front of a camera, he said, our main focus now is raising wages of all Americans. And it was in ways pathetic that, you know, there are only like three people from the national media there, Melanie Trautman from the Wall Street Journal, Don Gagne from NPR, and I. So he clearly had prepared these articulate talking points, but in many ways, no one was listening. I was thinking 30, 40 years ago when George Meany was president of the AFL-CIO, there probably would have been 10 TV cameras in the room and people would really have been paying attention. So, you know, labor realizes that it has problems in the public eye, even though its favorability ratings have rebounded, and they're really trying to reach out to figure out how to reinvigorate themselves, how to rebuild themselves, how to lift themselves. And they're taking some very different initiatives from what labor took in the past. They said, we realize we can't get things through Congress on our own. So they're forming alliances with NAACP, Sierra Club, National Council of La Raza, AARP. And they realize that they, to survive, really need to link up with other progressive groups. They're really working very, very, very closely with immigrant groups. At this news briefing the other day, Trumka, I've never saw him so impassioned. He said, we view the 11 million undocumented people in the United States as citizens in everything but on paper. And I think, yes, as a matter of social justice, he thinks these people should be given a path to citizenship, but clearly the labor movement sees immigrants, immigrant workers, as an important future source of union membership in the future. And unions are also working more closely than ever with worker centers, which seem to have much more spirit, which are growing much faster than the union movement. And here in New York are some of the nation's most successful worker centers. In Brooklyn and Queens, there's Make the Road by Walking, founded by Andrew Friedman, an NYU Law School graduate. Domestic Workers United, founded in New York, it represents housekeepers, nannies all around the country, founded by Ai-Jen Poo, a brilliant Columbia University graduate. There's the Taxi Workers Alliance, but if I say, grew up in New Jersey, daughter of Indian parents. She's built this group with 31,000 members. that's been able to improve taxi drivers' wages by pushing fares up and winning health coverage for the drivers. So in many ways, where the excitement is, where the energy is, isn't so much in labor unions right now, but it's almost these homegrown movements where groups of workers, especially immigrant workers, say something is wrong and we need to do something about it. And one of the most interesting things is almost all of these worker centers have been founded by women, and they've really taken off. Happy to talk more about VW later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I agree with probably 65% of what Steve said.
Which is 64% more than usual.
No, that's nice. You know, and let me admit, I did start my time in the labor movement working for a small union, a plaintiff's law firm actually in Baltimore, with the United Mine Workers in the big 77 to 78 strike, back when the mine workers really were at the top of their game, but really ending at that also. And that was sort of, as I was telling Cindy, the last big nationwide strike when they were taking on big oil. And certainly one thing that taught me, along with my current job, is there's lots of good arguments on either side. And it's unfortunate that in the labor management area, people do become much more polarized and rarely cross the Rubicon to the other side. In fact, I can't think of anybody, actually, off the top of my head who's gone back and forth. And I was young in my career then, so I was able to do it. I do work with the labor unions on immigration. Certainly, we have aligned ourselves with both the SEIU and the AFL on immigration reforms. On other things, obviously, we have a lot of big differences. Labor tends to be one of them. Now, with regard to the VW strike, and I'm just going to mention it quickly because I know Cindy's going to hit. I've been doing this long enough. I tend to not read big things into individual occasions. Now, we've got so many people writing so many stories in the press because there are so many outlets for the press. They got to write about something. And every reporter is calling me every day trying to get some snippet that they can write into something to make a storyline out of. It gets tiring. But the problem with that is everybody wants to read an event as a big deal. So for example, immigration reform, I would say the press has said it's been dead at least 25 times, and then all of a sudden it comes back. Well, they don't say they're continuing to work on immigration reform, they're saying immigration's dead, because that's the headline. That's easier to write, and it's more sort of alarming. And with what happened in Chattanooga, look, it certainly wasn't good news for the union. I think personally, and of course, Stephen know much more, I haven't been out there. My guess is it was the name of the union itself and its close allegiance to what happened to the car companies up in Detroit, which was clearly an issue of both management and the unions, what happened to the car companies in Detroit. That was their biggest problem going into that election. Look, I think that on our side, we will spin this, and I think there's some accuracy to that, that since the unions thought, based on their card checks, that going into that, they were going to win the election, that there's a very good argument, which we made during the Employee Free Choice Act, that you can't trust cards, and there's lots of reasons why employees sign cards. It can't be taken as meaning they actually support the union. And we had that whole argument during EFCA, as Steve knows, and they had many union organizers say exactly that. And I think certainly what happened in Chattanooga bears that out. The other part is that this whole argument that the unions raise about the reasons they are using elections is because employers are hiring so-called persuaders or labor consultants that give the employees only one side of the story, and the unions don't have the time to tell their side of the story during a union organizing campaign, hence the speedy election rule coming out of the NLRB. Since VW was neutral on this, there's an argument there that calls into question that it's not employer coercion or half-truths that result in unions losing elections. So what does that bring you to? That means there's something wrong with the product that the unions are selling. And I did say this to Steve, I think 10 years in the story, and I'm proud that many people have picked it up since then. But if the unions were a company and they were having continuing loss of product share from one-third, which they had in the 50s, to whatever it is now in the private sector, 7%, someone would wake up and say there's something wrong with the product they're selling. They wouldn't necessarily say there must be a problem with the way the product is being positioned in the marketplace, like on the wrong shelf, although that might be a factor. There's something wrong with what we're selling, and let's rejuggle it so we have a product that the consumer, i.e. the workers, can appreciate. Now, I know other people will say, no, it's not the product, it's the mean employers, et cetera, et cetera. You know, my guess is, as Steve said, there are bad employers out there and they deserve to be unionized, but, you know, it's not either or. And when Steve said, I think the unions have woken up to the fact that they have a problem with the images in the public eye, I'm not sure they know that. And every September I do a Labor Day press conference and I go through sort of what have the union leaders said about the employer community. I mean, John Sweeney, great guy, he called the employer community in one quote I remember a terrorist. You know, it's the kind of quotes like that that I think American workers can read and say, well, you know, I got a tough job, but my employer is not a terrorist. And it's a lot of that sort of over-the-top rhetoric, I'll call it over-the-top, that sort of emanates from a sense that maybe things really haven't changed from the 1930s, when in fact they really have. And it could be a situation here where, Sydney will get into this, I'm sure, where employers have really done, I mean, unions have done a job too well. Obviously, a lot of benefits are now mandated by Congress. They don't bargain for those anymore. One question, Steve, we can talk about it is with the advent of Obamacare, have unions lost a key thing to bargain over, and how will that affect their ability to organize workers? That is health care. I mean, that really leaves pensions and wages on the table, but a lot of those other things are now set by federal legislation. And we can go on at sort of the reasons for there are still, well, right down the street here in New York, there was a report that came out from the Maritime Commission on union corruption with the port in the area. And if you read that kind of, if you read through that, and I've got it here, it's some eye-opening examples of that the public can relate to on nepotism within the union movement, et cetera. And that gives the unions a bad name. There's problems with how the unions handle so-called Beck rights, which is the right of employees to object to the political use of their dues. Why the SEIU went up to the Supreme Court with a case called Knox, in which they lost overwhelmingly in the Supreme Court, in which they refused to allow workers to exercise their so-called Beck rights to object to the use of political spending under a special assessment in California, is beyond me. And believe me, I know the guys in the SEIU, and I said, what the heck were you guys thinking? And it was like, hey, that wasn't my decision. Well, that was a major, I think that's a major problem. I'm not saying workers read Supreme Court decisions, but there's been a fair amount of press on that. So there are some image issues with the unions. Steve, I've read your book, most of it. There's a lot of bad stuff in there and that pulls at your heartstrings. On the other side, I wish we'd had a second chapter in there. If you had called me, we might have written another book about what employers are doing for their employees in terms of providing health care for 174 million Americans and providing pension benefits. And there is a story to be told there. And in fact, if you look at the polls, and I have them here, you'll find that the polling of most Americans finds that they are fairly satisfied with their jobs. So if Americans are fairly satisfied with their job, most employers are doing a decent job, a decent effort to keep their employees happy on the job, so they'll come back, be productive. That's a problem for unions who are coming in saying, look, you really need us to protect you from your employer. So there's always another side of these stories, and I think I tend to look at like workplaces individualized. I work for IBM, it wasn't on my bio there. IBM, 1974, it was well known. They did not want to be unionized, but they made a point of bringing up their benefits and pay to match the union scale so they wouldn't be unionized. That's because unions were there, and that's a good thing that the work of the unions resulted in. It, however, makes the unions, it makes it a lot tougher to organize employees. So what's the future for the union movement? And I know you talked about this a little bit in your paper, Cindy. I'm not sure. I think the leadership has to change their rhetoric with demonizing the employer community because it just doesn't fit modern reality as perceived, I think, by most workers, as certainly is demonstrated by polls. And there's going to have to be a true creative way, different way of thinking about approaching workers. I tend to see the same thing over and over again over the last decade in how unions are approaching these elections. The VW thing was a little bit of a different wrinkle. Still had that result. So with that, that's all.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, good afternoon. I learned a long time ago as a college professor, this is the most dangerous time of the afternoon ever to talk. So it's good that we'll have a little bit of a debate and an argument here. Although there are points that I agree with both Randy and Steve. I want to make four points about the need for fundamental change in the labor movement, or in whatever we're going to call the labor movement of the future. We'll probably have to have young people come up with a new name for whatever it is that we call the institutions that give voice to workers and represent their interests in society and at their places of work. But if we don't have fundamental change, some of the changes that Steve talked about and that Randy talked about, then we are going to have a labor movement that will get more and more separated from the public eye, from the positive things that they do, will get buried under all of the negative publicity. I'll use the Volkswagen case only to illustrate the need for fundamental change. And now I'm going to go back to something that is even 30 years old, but still accurate. For the first time ever in the 1970s, the Labor Department sponsored a survey called the Quality of Work Survey, done by the University of Michigan, a very reputable national survey. And the first time they ever asked workers, if an election was held on your job, would you join a union? There had been various little studies like this. I had done one or two of those, but never on a national sample. And the results have stood up ever since. And let me just tell you what those results indicate about when you get workers to say yes. Well, the first thing is you have to have a highly dissatisfied workforce. People have to either distrust their employer or really hate their job. And it's not that they have to be marginally unhappy. They have to really be distrustful, have experiences that reinforce that, and feel that something needs to change. That's point number one. Point number two is that they then have to believe that the union will be instrumental to changing the conditions and the things that they really care about. And there's a whole bunch of data and all kinds of analysis that goes behind that, but there has to be a belief that the union will be able to make a difference on the things that are really most dissatisfying to them. And then number three, those are the two dominant things. American workers are pragmatic. They make decisions based on their real interpretations of their situation. But there is this thing out there called ideology, and it's latent. And what we discovered in those data was kind of a big labor image. Some of the things that Randy talked about. If people have those images, that moderates their pragmatism. And that will influence them, not as strongly as the pragmatic, but it'll influence them. And when it gets elevated, it has a real influence. Well, I think I just described what's going on, what happened in Chattanooga. Here you had a workforce that wasn't deeply dissatisfied. It was pretty happy with Volkswagen. Volkswagen's a good employer. But the union was saying, we will give you a works council, and we will give you voice. But it wasn't able to show the workforce what is it that we will really provide that addresses something that you're not getting now that you really care deeply about. Enough people cared about the works council, as Steve said, to vote positively. But those two conditions weren't there. And then when you elevate the visibility of the really awful kind of rhetoric that was used in the investments of the opponents of unionization in the community and the government, not only now replicated in South Carolina, but certainly we all saw it there, that was enough to change those 44 votes that were needed to tip the balance any other way. Now, Volkswagen is not unique. If that's the situation, I would suggest that this organizing model is never going to lead to a revival of the labor movement. We are never going to be able to get 51% of workers in elections to overcome resistance on the ideology side, or at this point in time to see that unions have enough to offer to make a difference. So basically, unions need a very, very different recruiting model, and that's the first point. If it takes 50% to vote that they are so dissatisfied to get one new union member, then we will never reverse this downward trend. We have more former union members in the United States than there are current union members. And we're not going to change that. That's been a reality for a very long time. Even though there are many people out there who want representation in those polls, when I did that study or used those data in 1979, 33% of the workforce said they would join a union. Now that number is up to about, depending which poll you use, but reasonably good polls, 40 to 50% would vote. So something has changed in the material conditions that workers have that they believe they need to see something better at their workplace. But it's not really possible to get there, to get 51% with the way in which it operates. So labor needs a recruiting model that doesn't depend on whether I am so dissatisfied with my job that I'll turn to almost anything. It doesn't need a model. It needs to get away from a model where they have to have a majority to vote in order to get one new union member. And then if we have more former union members in the United States than we have current union members, it needs a model that holds on to members for their lifetime, sort of like universities do. You know, once you're here, they find you regardless of where the hell you are in the world for some reason or another. But the serious point is we need continuity of membership. We need services that carry across jobs as people move from one job to another. We need services that workers feel are valuable for improving their skills and making them more mobile and making them more competitive in the labor market, and that provide them with the kind of tools that they need to be successful. We also need an organizing model that gets away from the workplace. As long as we're organizing at a workplace where the employer really does control an awful lot of the environment and the atmosphere and the conditions, we shouldn't depend on lousy employers to be the source of union organizing, and we shouldn't necessarily have to vote at the workplace. People should be able to join unions as individuals or organizations, whatever we call them. That's the need for a new organizing model. Point number two, collective bargaining, as much as I love it and have practiced it and mediate it and facilitate it and work on interest-based and new models of collaboration, is only one model for giving workers voice. It's time that we open up this law. I've argued this 20 years ago with the same effect that I will get today, that we need multiple models, multiple ways. So yes, if the workers at Volkswagen want a works council, there ought to be ways that they should be able to get it, including with union representation for collective bargaining, or maybe some other creative ways, as long as it's a bona fide form of representation and independently chosen by the people involved, and so it has some legitimacy as a mechanism at the workplace. That's only one model. Steve mentioned a whole variety of new approaches. These are fantastic because, you know, the one organization he didn't mention, but I know he knows a lot about, is the Restaurant Opportunity Centers. Well, they're, quote, not a union. And they're taking advantage of not being a union. Now they're being attacked by some of Randy's colleagues for saying, well, they really are a union in other clothing. But they aren't constrained by this crazy labor law that was passed in 1935 that has been outmoded or ossified, as my good friend Cindy has copyrighted that term, unfortunately, has pointed out for a number of years. We need to open that up to multiple forms of representation so that collective bargaining can be one viable choice, but alternative forms of voice and representation are needed. Steve made the point that I'm going to make as my third point here, and that is unions need coalitions. One of the saddest things, and I Steve quoted a colleague of ours at Middle Tennessee University in an earlier piece a while ago, and this same colleague said to me a long time before this election, the UAW is not drawing on us in the community. They're not really building coalitions with the people who they're going to need, much less the academics and the others down there who are interested in these kinds of issues. They don't join in engaging us, and they will pay a price for it, and I think they did. They did not have. The community folks come out and counter all that negative propaganda. The only people who could have done that, perhaps, are the church religious leaders, the community leaders who have credibility there, that say these are decent people, they shouldn't be vulgarized the way they are. So we need these kinds of coalitions, and we need these kinds of new groups that are organizing outside of the law. And I believe fundamentally, knowing what I know about organizational design and organizational change, that if we want fundamental change, it's not going to come from inside the AFL-CIO, as much as they say they want to do it, and as much as I agree with what Steve said, that Rich Trumka is serious about it, so is Mary Kay Henry at the service employees, so are many of her local leaders around the country and counterparts within the AFL-CIO, but they're constrained by the legacy structures and politics and organizational arrangements. And that's going to make it harder for them to be the drivers of change. So we need alternative, greenfield kind of organizations and groups like Restaurant Opportunity Center, like the Taxi Drivers Alliance, like people in Florida and that have come together and developed a coalition to upgrade the rights of farm workers and Indians working in very adverse conditions there. That's going to be the greenfield sites, the experimental sites, the incubators for innovation, and then the labor movement working in coalition can perhaps adjust. And then finally, now this is, you know, I might as well sit down and not even say this because it's, but we're in an academic setting, so I suppose I can say something academic. Well, Cindy is right. So are many of the other people in this room who have written about this and studied it and practiced it. Our labor law is broken. Our labor law has been broken for a long time. It doesn't need the Employee Free Choice Act. That would have made a marginal change at best. It needs a fundamental restructuring and a fundamental updating to fit the workforce we find today, to fit the fissured and multiple forms of organization of work and corporate structures that we find today, and to meet the needs of the modern workforce for the forms of voice that are important to them. And so we do need fundamental labor law change, updating, not reform, but fundamental change. We aren't going to get that in the short run. So now I would just say, let a thousand flowers bloom. If we could somehow open this law up, and I'm not the expert, I'm not a lawyer, a labor lawyer, if we could open it up to experimentation the way we have done in a whole bunch of other social policy like healthcare and everything else, and continue to learn from the state and local experiments, and I don't mean Wisconsin, I think we could make real, real progress, and I think someday we will. My final point, I'm delighted that the 18 to 29 year olds are more favorable to unions. I happen to be hallucinating these days because I'm on sabbatical, and I've essentially given up on my generation. And so my project at the moment is to ask, how can we engage the next generation to figure out how they are going to deal with the mess that we are leaving them? Because we are leaving them a mess, an economic mess, a political mess, and a lack of opportunity at the workplace. They're inheriting it, and we better start to engage them so that they can come up with the solutions that work best for them. I'm not sure exactly how I'm going to do that yet. I've been told that an old guy like me can't just tell the next generation that we're leaving you a mess and you need to fix it and here's what you need to do. They don't think that will work, and they're right. But I think we can engage them in new ways to help them figure out how to deal with this. Thank you.
So I would very much like to second that let a thousand flowers bloom message, but any organization that represents workers has to kind of go one of two ways. And we hear both of these messages coming out of the current labor movement. One is, we will fight for you. This is about distributional conflict, and we are going to fight for you, and you're going to fight together to get more. The other message is, we're going to cooperate with management to increase the size of the pie to make this a more prosperous industry, and we will try to make sure that you get your share. Now, ironically, it seems like the UAW got it both ways. They were, some of what I read in Steve's article suggested that they were criticized for being too cooperative with management, being too willing to take into account competitive realities, and they're not likely to fight for the workers. to get higher wages. But then, of course, the union's reputation from its past in Detroit was they fought too hard, they got too much. They helped bring the industry down. What's especially ironic is that VW UAW had actually come up with a solution to this huge dilemma, and that is you kind of need two different institutions to do these two different things. So you do need an organization that fights for workers over distributional conflict, but you also need a mechanism for workplace cooperation. Really hard for a single institution to do both of those things. But the question I wanted to toss out to the panelists each in turn is, what about that fundamental choice? There are voices within the union, many voices on the left saying the problem was that UAW wasn't fighting hard enough, they gave away too much, they were too cooperative. And then obviously a lot of voices from the other side saying, you know, unions haven't been able to show that they can actually help management run a more prosperous and productive industry. How are unions supposed to deal with that conflict?
Can I arrogate myself to start. First, I want to agree with something that Randy and Tom said. And in many ways, unions have conflicting images, and a lot of it is their historical legacy. On the one hand, you know, they boast that we, better than any group in society, can help raise your wages, can reduce inequality. And it is an attractive message for many people, especially a lot of young people nowadays. On the other hand, and I think this really hurt them at Volkswagen, you know, people see that, you know, while a lot of union leaders might say all these great sounding things, a lot of union locals themselves are dead wood. A lot of local union leaders work 5 hours a day, then they go play golf. I've called up too many union offices in my life at 3:30 in the afternoon and there's no one there. And there is kind of a disconnect. You know, unions are trying to kind of come out of their old shell and show that they're a new shiny butterfly, but they still, you know, have this legacy problem of past corruption, of stifling bureaucracy, of some, you know, local union officials who, you know, just, you know, want to have a sinecure and not do very much. So when I hear union leaders speak, it's all where the folks are going to fight the Koch brothers, where the folks are going to fight inequality, where the folks are going to raise your wages, and there's very little focus on changing some of these other problems. And the second, very quickly, at Volkswagen, the UAW was in a damned if you do, damned if you don't position. The politicians, the Republican governor, Bill Haslam, Senator Bob Corker, Bo Watson, an influential state senator who threatened that if the union were to win, then we'll cut off all future subsidies to the plant, and that will make it very hard for the plant ever to attract other lines. They kept saying, the UAW is bad, look what it did to Detroit, it's too confrontational. If it comes into Chattanooga, it's gonna make the plant less competitive. And I think that message hit home with a lot of workers. So the UAW, Bob King, the president of the UAW, kept trying to say, we are not your father's UAW, we're a new UAW, we're much more cooperative. And they signed this agreement with Volkswagen that basically promised to keep wages competitive, to keep wages below those of the Detroit automakers. So on one hand, some workers were damning it for being too confrontational. On the other hand, some workers read this agreement between the UAW and Volkswagen where the UAW is basically saying, hey, we'll work with VW to keep down your wages because we're not trying to be confrontational, we're trying to be cooperative to maintain your competitiveness. And I think a lot of workers thought, who needs this? Why should I be paying union dues if the UAW is promising to help restrain wages? And I think that critique was coming from the right inside the plant rather than from the left inside the plant.
I mean, well, in terms of what Steve just said, I certainly agree with that. It's funny, when the whole expanding the pie, Cindy, that's what I had Andy Stern talk to my labor relations committee when he was newly elected to head up the SEIU and then change to win. And that's exactly what he said. He said, we got to get away from confrontation and figure out a way to expand the pie. You know, I will say that I think on the ground floor, most of management don't view unions as partners, or they see union leaders as getting in the way of making management decisions that would expand the pie. and I'm not saying it's right or wrong, I'm just giving you the viewpoint, rather than redistributing the existing pie. And all I can tell you is these are people who know a lot more about what's going on in the factory floor than I do, and that's their view. And I think a lot of it might go back to the old work rules that unions used to impose in terms of no job sharing, et cetera, and I think the unions are moving away from that, but it's still a problem. So that's the message. I don't know how to convince people that, in fact, in management, that it's, unions really want to expand the pie, and there's a way of doing that in an effectual way.
So I guess one problem that unions face in putting out the message, we're going to cooperate and help this business become more productive, is that it's not clear, it's hard to convey how unions can help management do its job better. But Tom, if I could sort of spin my original question that way and send it your way, maybe you could address that.
There are lots of examples where unions have contributed and continue to contribute to making the workplace a better place. I've done a lot of work in the auto industry. We did a lot of work at Saturn, and in the early years, that's exactly what happened there. But now, for the last decade, I've been working with Kaiser Permanente, the big healthcare, both insurer and provider, mostly on the West Coast, but has operations scattered around the country as well. And they've got a coalition of unions that has been extremely militant and extremely cooperative, but engaged in decisions, sharing decisions in ways that really add value. And I'll give you two examples. Kaiser is the leader in the use of electronic medical records technology. Now, there's two reasons for that. One is that they have the incentive to do it because if they keep people healthy, they're both the insurer and the provider, and therefore the savings flow right to their bottom line. That's really important, has nothing to do with anything else other than that economic incentive and the fact that they understand that, they're smart people, and they've therefore said, you know, we should really use these technologies effectively. But the other reason is the labor management partnership. They have negotiated an employment security arrangement where the chart room operator, workers who, you know, used to handle all this paper, and everyone else who's displaced by these technologies gets retrained, redeployed, and has a coach, a union coach, to help them find the opportunities. They have union coaches to help people adapt to this new technology, and where they have the most effective use of the technology in improving healthcare, based on very solid research that some of my students have done, is where they have the workforce engaged and the union engaged with making these technologies pay off and reaching out to patients, reaching out to their insured population to make sure that they are using the services for preventive care. That's the modern form of labor management relations. When they sit down to negotiate, they use all of the interest-based negotiating tools and problem-solving tools that they've been trained in to really engage. So they have teams working on work-family issues, on absenteeism issues, on issues around how they're going to revise their retiree health care program, which is in trouble just like everybody else's, on issues around scope of practice and new technology and new ways of improving health care delivery. And then at the workplace, they are the leader in the use of work-based teams. They have more teams of nurses and doctors and service employees working together on improvement processes than any other healthcare company in the country. Now, that's the modern form. Are there problems there? There are big problems there. There are internal union battles. There are problems with some doctors and some managers who don't buy into the partnership. But the leadership does. The middle managers are coming along. There are some union leaders who don't buy in very well. But this is part of a change process. Now, Kaiser is a unique kind of situation. Why do you get this kind of development there? It's because unions were already strong at Kaiser. How you get that in a situation where you don't have any strength, how you get management to be cooperative with a union when they say, I'd rather escape unions than deal with them, is the big problem. And so I think the only way we will get to that model spreading broadly across the country is if unions or workers themselves start to demand it and really become the champions of this new model. And that is going to require education, that's going to require workers themselves saying, we want to be engaged that way, and we want to have a real voice, and we want to be listened to, and we want to do it in a way that is that keeps the social relations at work being positive, cooperative, and able to meet our patients' needs. That's what you hear from the frontline workers at Kaiser. They're more satisfied with their unions today than they were prior to the partnership. They've rated, I don't know if I trust this, but some firm has just called Kaiser the second happiest place in the world, in the country to work.
In Colorado?
No, nationally. I don't know. I don't know if I trust that.
In Washington State, not Colorado.
Okay. Yeah.
But in any event, it's employment satisfaction. It's turnover, which I do believe is a better indicator, is much lower than anybody else in healthcare. And so they're doing something right there. But they're doing it on the basis of a strong union presence.
But Tom, I would say that is a case study of which perhaps the unions, I don't know, ought to package and make more of, in terms of here's an example of how it's worked with one employer, and can that be replicated in other employer situations? I don't, whether it's that unique or not, I didn't know about that, and I don't know if Steve did, but Kaiser's a member of the chamber. So that is a good example of how it can work, and whether it's unique or not, I don't know, but it's kind of a case study that might be the union leadership ought to package and say it can work. And maybe they have. I don't know about them.
I wanted to throw out one more question and get some discussion on it before we open things up. And that is, Steve brought this question up of the political dimension of these battles. So a couple of things have happened since the 1960s, say. The two parties have pulled further apart, and they've sorted themselves pretty completely. And that, you know, we call that polarization, and some parts of the country are particularly polarized. At the same time, unions in the last couple of decades have put more of their resources into politics and become very closely associated with the Democratic Party and Democratic Party political officials. And so to what extent is that a big part? I mean, I think you saw a fair bit of that influencing the election of EW, but to what extent can we generalize from that? Is are the politicization of unions and the polarization of politics part of what makes it difficult to then bring workers together in parts of the country where Republicans have a lot of strength, and also difficult, then you predictably have political weighing in against the union because they're enemies at this point.
I think, good question, Cindy. I think, you know, some of the postmortems of what happened in Volkswagen, and, you know, I think there are 10 different reasons why the union lost. One of them, I think, is some, you know, the UAW, as I said before, acknowledge that probably a majority of the plant was Republican. I'd say 85, 90, 95% of the plant was white. And if the plant were, you know, 40% black, African American, I would think it would have, you know, the vote would have come out differently. So I think the fact that the majority of the plant's workers are Republican, and the UAW does have a reputation as being a very liberal union, and I imagine that could have cost the UAW some votes. Now, you know, the Republican leadership of the state of Tennessee, the governor, the most prominent senator, the head of the assembly in the state legislature, you know, all really spoke out very vigorously against the union. And I think, you know, for Republicans, you know, it's like a win-win-win to speak out against the union. I think it pleases their base, the Republican base, the Tea Party folks, the contributors, the donors, to really stick it to the union. I think they are sincerely worried that if the union were to win, it would hurt the area's business image and make it harder to attract future investment. And third, you know, they certainly don't want the activist, liberal, progressive UAW with its political war chest coming into Tennessee and making it easier to elect Democrats. So I think you're right there. You know, so I've been on this beat covering labor for a long time, and, you know, 10, 15 years ago, I used to find, you know, 10, 15, 20 Republicans in Congress, and Randy would agree, you know, who would really back unions on various issues. And there were, you know, I forget the guy in Buffalo, Jack...
Quinn.
Jack Quinn. He was very pro-union. And, you know, Jack Quinn, you know, basically quit his seat because he was disgusted with how, I'm being honest here, you know, how conservative the Republican Party, how polarized things were. And I don't know of any pro-union
Republicans
left in the House. So that's one of the reasons. I think the unions really lined up with the Democrats partly because they felt, you know, virtually every Republican is against them, but also they see that they face real problems organizing, so they think, well, we could, by electing Democrats, we can get people to vote for laws like the Employee Free Choice Act card check that would make it easier for them to unionize, but they haven't had that much luck there either.
No, they haven't. And you know, I think there's two parts. This one is what's going on in Washington, D.C., and Jack Quinn's story was he wanted, last time we raised the minimum wage, I was in the House under the Republicans, and Jack Quinn wanted to offer the amendment, and we took it from him, gave it to Frank Riggs, because Riggs needed to use it in this election. Jack was very pissed off. Maybe that's why he left. But Jack was a great guy. He was very liberal, didn't vote the right way ever, in my view. You guys get a chance. You got to look at the letters to the editor today. It's on the Volkswagen thing. But Cynthia, I got to read one of these because it plays right into your political
question.
Would
this be the Wall Street Journal?
Wall Street Journal, okay. Sorry. Yeah. What did I do?
Nothing.
Oh. I've always believed that unions represent an important role in representing workers. Yet many years ago, when working at Bethlehem Steel, I was shocked by the United Steelworkers newsletter, which is replete with left-wing propaganda. Today, this trend continues as unions seem more interested in using workers' dues to forward a liberal agenda rather than representing the workers. Perhaps if unions dropped their politics, which must turn off many of their members, and reverted to protecting the workers, they would do better in elections. Now, back in Ronald Reagan's day and a little after that, you would see the polls where 40% of union members were actually voting Republican. Now, I don't think it's not that high these days, and that's why we don't see the polls anymore. But that was where, clearly, the union agenda. And back then, the unions also were getting into more than workplace law issues. They were getting into things like gun control and back the Democratic Party up in issues that were related to the workplace. And that clearly turned off a lot of union members. It has to be, as this letter to the editor indicates, it's got to be still an issue. And as Steve, I think, indicated, that affects people's willingness to am I going to give the dues to a body that's aligned with a party that I pretty much disagree with, meaning the Democrats. In terms of why the unions went to the Democrats versus Republicans, you know, I don't know which is the chicken and the egg and which started first. Certainly the unions have been allied with the Democratic Party, I would guess back to, now that I think about it, since going back to Truman's veto of Taft-Hartley was certainly before 1947.
FDR.
I think Truman vetoed Taft-Hartley.
No, but they went.
Oh, yeah, FDR, right, but Truman vetoed it because they overrid him. The problem is if the unions aren't going to be able to go forward with their agenda by organizing more workers, they're going to turn to the other. And of course, this was an ongoing argument between Andy Stern and John Sweeney. Do you put your money in organizing or do you put it on Capitol Hill? You put it on Capitol Hill and change the labor laws to make it organizing, therefore you can organize more workers. That was certainly Sweeney's approach. And as Steve indicated, that wasn't successful, even on the margins. Even on the TMAC, which we haven't talked about, you can't make major changes in labor laws. So it's a quandary for the unions because the more they ally themselves with the Democrats, the more it turns off some of their base. And I don't have an answer to it. Unfortunately, it's not my job to give them the answer to it. It's a problem. I would think they should stay out of, I think there's less involvement in pure social issues such as gun control and that sort of thing, and stick to, you know, the real fundamentals of workplace issues. But let's be clear: the unions are they may only have 7% of the private sector workforce, extremely powerful on Capitol Hill, a lot of money, often wish the chamber could raise dues the way the unions can, So they're a very, very powerful force on Capitol Hill, and they'll remain so.
It's a little bit difficult to tell a labor union leader in Wisconsin. As Steve said, I grew up there. I have lots of family there. I was benefited from education system in the university and feel very strongly about what has happened there. It's a little hard to tell a union leader in Wisconsin that they should stay out of politics when it was the money that was poured into Scott Walker's campaign and everyone else who would stand with him, that really changed the law and decimated public sector unions in Wisconsin. That, if you could call a truce magically and get business out of labor politics and get labor out of business politics, I think that would be a deal the labor movement should take in a moment. But that's not the reality in the world today. And so, yes, unions have to be active in politics. I don't believe that's going to be the solution to their problem, but I think it's a necessary activity, and I think they have to do it better. I think they have to do it smarter. I think they have to go right to the grassroots level and just argue that this is unfair, the unfairness of what has happened in Wisconsin, the unfairness of the fact that we haven't seen wages go up and a minimum wage go up since 2007, but we've seen the value of that minimum wage fall, the fact that young people can't earn a living even with a college graduate degree. Those are the things that unions have to sell to the public, but they have to do it in new ways. And they have to do it through the leaders that Steve mentioned, the women who are leading these alternative organizations. They're the ones who have to be out there in front. You can't have people of my age and maybe 50 pounds heavier out there telling young people what they need, or anyone in the public what they need. We need the workforce of the future saying this is what we need, and we'll take it through politics, we'll take it through grassroots efforts, we'll take it in partnership, but we expect the business community to work with us. That's the way I think the political message has to be packaged.
Cindy, I do want to clarify on this sort of objections to Senator Corker's intervening or making certain statements during the campaign and other ad billboards and such.
No,
I spent 10 years on Capitol Hill, and the unions routinely went to Ted Kennedy and George Miller and others to ask them to intervene in employer disputes, whether writing letters, implicit pressure. And the whole concept of union corporate campaigns is enlisting, and I'm not saying it's a very effective tactic, actually, is enlisting outside allies such as the church, as church officials or local public officials to help the organizing, underlying organizing effort. So the whole, what was interesting in Chattanooga is it's actually quite rare to see, Steve might disagree, relatively rare to see the conservative groups weighing in that sort of way, putting Wisconsin aside. We can talk money in a second, but certainly the unions have played that game for a long, long time. And this be kind of curious, Cindy, if there's some effort to file a ULP based on the intervention or persuasion of public officials, how that would play out. I think it'd be very unprecedented, but be an interesting ULP.
One additional thought. So I think Randy's right that, you know, when for, you know, a workforce as at Volkswagen that's, you know, probably 60-70% Republican, I think the fact that the UAW, you know, is viewed as a very progressive, you know, liberal, left, you know, even lefty union, I think it hurt the union somewhat. But I think Tom's also right that, you know, if the union said we're going to get out of politics in order to attract more votes, and, you know, if labor stopped giving money to the Democrats, the Republicans would very quickly control the Senate, and then Republicans will do on a nationwide basis what they did in Wisconsin. I think. You know, a lot of unions are saying, look, you know, we lost at Volkswagen. That was kind of a well-paid workforce. And as Tom said, you know, they were a pretty satisfied workforce. They were paid well. They were treated well. They weren't sure why to vote for a union. But I think unions are increasingly focusing on immigrant workers, African-American workers. And there, I don't think they'll be hurt so badly by the fact that unions are perceived as democratic.
Well, right, we can talk about immigrant workers and their political leanings once we get through immigration, turn over to the Republican Party.
Are we talking Cuban immigrants or no?
Okay, so let's open it up to questions. You come to the microphone. I see Jim Brudney, who will be on the next panel.
This is for you.
Thanks. Very interesting panel. I guess I have a question for Steve and a question for Randy, but I'm perfectly happy to have Tom chime in on either one. The question for Steve has to do with the title of the panel in terms of unions in the public eye, and I heard him say that he's going to spend some time in Madison sort of surveying the decimated state of the landscape for public employees there, and I think that's well worth doing. I wonder about the parallel story in Ohio, where what happened at the exact same time, as he knows well, is a strong and well-funded effort to roll back collective bargaining for public employees. It was fought not with a recall election, which arguably was all that Wisconsin had available but lost, but with a referendum, which won hugely, and arguably Governor Kasich is a different governor with respect to things like Medicaid money for Obamacare and a variety of other things as a result of that set of public pushback. So I'm wondering whether, because he is the leading voice in the media, in the print media, for what's going on in the country, whether a review of what's going on in Ohio isn't at least important in the context of reviewing what's going on in Wisconsin. And my question for Randy really goes to the byplay that was just going on in terms of Governor Corker. Obviously, Senator Kennedy, Senator Metzenbaum, lots of people were involved in.
As you well know, Jim.
As I well know, having worked for both of them. The behind the scenes aspects of trying to pressure or negotiate for changes. This is a little different in terms of using the bully pulpit to, some would say, threaten workers with the consequences of a vote. So my question for you is, do you see any limit to what a public official can do or say when they are perceived to have the kind of authority that the governor of Tennessee or the mayor of Chattanooga or the senator from Tennessee has in explaining the consequences of voting one way or another?
Jim, so about 6, 8, 9 months ago, Mike Podhortzer, who is here this morning, held a briefing for the press, kind of totally showing labor's hands for, you know, his plans for this year's campaign, saying our focus is taking out these four governors in the Midwest. Scott Walker, who passed an anti-collective bargaining law, John Kasich, who did as well, but it was repealed, Rick Snyder, the Michigan governor, who passed right to work, and Ray Corbett, right? Ray, the governor of Pennsylvania, who's now considering a bill that would make it harder for public sector unions to collect dues. And labor's going to be very big in this year's campaign. And when I was in Houston yesterday, discussing their political strategy, they're going after these four guys because they feel those four governors and the Republicans control both houses of the legislature there, and those are real. All four states are former labor, labor strongholds. All four states are key battleground states in every presidential election. And the labor question, so to speak, is going to really be central, at least in these Midwest races. Might they fight Scott Walker more than they will fight Corbett? Probably. I mean, because they really see Walker as the symbol above all. And Kasich's been a little more moderate on some issues like Medicaid, so that might tone down some of labor's opposition to Kasich.
Well, first of all, I'm a big fan of Kasich, and I hope he runs. But I worked with him in the House, and Ohio's one deal, Wisconsin's another, and Kasich took a different route. And I think they're both going to be players on the political scene as we go into the presidential elections. Jim, I do want to, Ted Kennedy Metzenbaum thing. I mean, I've seen, if you look in the corporate campaigns where unions have enlisted corporate officials to, for example, not grant zoning waivers to build certain, like I think one was a cancer ward, unless they agreed an organizing campaign. So it's rough. It's rough out there. Was what happened in Chattanooga different? And is there a limit? Is there a limit to what a politician can say? Well, as you well know, I worked for Kennedy Metzenbaum, his speech and debate clause wasn't in the Senate. It's a political response to them. It's not a legal one. It's an interesting whether or not it can it be so bad that it taints the election process that it can amount to a ULP. And Cindy's saying there is precedent for that.
For ULP, for overturning the election.
Well, under a Gissel bargaining order or something? Or
overturning the election.
Just under Section 9 laboratory conditions.
Right.
Yeah, well, that's the Gissel bargaining order thing.
No, it doesn't have to be. It might be a rerun election.
Okay. It's not so tainted that it's against the bargaining order. So we'll see if the UAW goes that approach. Be an interesting, interesting case.
I would love to hear from some of those young people we keep talking about. Students, okay.
Hello, my name's Kyle. I'm a first-year student here at the law school. And I was curious, because to me, one of the major issues as far as unions in the public eye that was only touched on tangentially here is the issues of benefit plans and pension plans and the financial difficulties that they faced. And I know, Mr. Johnson, you referenced that briefly and actually kind of led into my question related to the Affordable Care Act and the impact that might have on it. Do you think it's possible that with the Affordable Care Act now in play, we'll see labor and management coming to agreements where unions cut back on health benefits in exchange for greater pension security and greater employer contributions to pension plans? And would that be something that, Mr. Johnson, you think employers would be receptive to doing?
Interesting question. I saw the article in the New York Times today on how state and local governments are cutting back on coverage they're rendering more and more employees part-time, so they won't be covered under President's health care law. And I didn't really see much in maybe I missed it in the Times story, I didn't see how the unions were reacting to that. There are parts of the labor movement that are very unhappy with Obamacare, as you know. That's an interesting, sure, when of course you're talking about a workforce that is organized, and you know that's about 8% of the workforce in the private sector, but the employer has to comply with certain mandates under the present health care bill, and those aren't fungible. Well, they've been fungible over the last year. Sure, I think that's a possibility. I mean, when an employer's going to look at this, he's got a certain amount, he's got a pot of money, and he's got to figure out how to use it, and some things you're going to have to give. If you're giving something over here, something else is going to have to give over here. I mean, to me, we don't have to go down this road. The pension crisis facing this country is just as big as the healthcare crisis in terms of particularly your generation and the mess that Tom mentioned we're leaving you guys in terms of entitlements. A lot of creative thinking has to be done in the pension area to keep employers in the market, both DC, not to mention DB, if that's possible. So,
defined benefit, defined contribution for the non-experts in the room. Yeah.
I don't think it's an issue of trading one off against another. The real trend is they've been both pension and health care benefits have been cut back enormously. I mean, we've destroyed the defined benefit plans in the private sector. They don't exist except for a few isolated places where they exist. They're largely in the public sector, and we haven't replaced them. Even though the costs have gone down, those savings have gone right to the corporate bottom line, or they have not been pushed back into wages. Wages haven't gone up as a result of pensions being cut back. Wages haven't gone up as a result of cutting back on health benefits, and won't. There's going to have to be a new deal that's struck somewhere. Was intrigued by the President's State of the Union message with, I think it's my retirement or something like that, a sort of a new form of retirement. Well, we need a new form of retirement, because 401ks aren't going to cut it. They're not covering enough people. Young people aren't saving enough. They're not doing it early enough in life to build up the savings that will give them a reasonable retirement. And so we're going to have to supplement Social Security with some form of a new pension plan that people have suggested, it's going to take a while to get there.
If you read some labor histories of the American labor movement, the 1910s, 1920s, 1930s, there was President Wilson talked about the labor question, because a lot of workers were paid miserable wages. A lot of them worked in very bad conditions, very unsafe conditions. And the series of presidents before FDR all debated what to do about the labor question. And the way it was sort of answered was the passage of the Wagner Act in 1935, giving private sector employees a federally guaranteed right to unionize. Now, with wages being fairly stagnant, with greater inequality, this whole labor question in a certain different form is rearing up again. And I think that's one of the reasons there's the survey has organized a conference about the vitality of labor. I think for many reasons, labor unions will not serve as the answer the way they, people aren't as ready to embrace unions now as they were in the 1920s and 1930s. But I think a lot of, you know, Americans, especially younger Americans, say something's wrong in the economy, our wages are too low, you know, we're not going to have pensions, we're going to have 401ks, which just don't cut it. And so, you know, I think, you know, as we're seeing with the fast food movement and the Our Walmart movement, you know, there is this labor question of inadequate wages for many, many, many Americans, and people are groping for answers about how to improve that.
In the spirit of negotiations, I want to make an offer to my friend Randy, and that is, you know, we don't have the kind of forums where people are sitting with business and labor and workers and educators talking about these issues. I mean, it's great that we're all here today, but this is unusual, and there used to be, as you know, a lot more of those kinds of forums. I would propose that we create a multi-party negotiations exercise, a simulation, and we get young people to sit down and learn just enough about their situation to know that there are some options, and get them to sit with business leaders, representatives of business, and representatives of labor, and say, what would the next social contract look like? What should it look like? What could it look like? How are we going to meet our aspirations for the American dream, or whatever you want to call it? And get people in the same room and see, get them to talk with each other. I'll bring the young people, I'll bring, anybody can bring the labor leaders, you bring the business leaders, and let's sit down and just, there's nothing at stake, because nobody's going to do anything about it, but let's start to engage in this way, and let's see what they would create out of whole cloth. Not out of a, you know, let's not put the modest reforms of labor law on the table. Let's put real reforms on the table as an option. Let's put real investment in retirement. Let's put real lifelong learning on the table. Let's put a wage that moves with productivity or profitability and skills and so on the table. And let's put work-family issues on the table. And let's put productivity and improvements in customer satisfaction and all of those on the table. Let's see what they would produce. That's the kind of dialogue we need. And maybe we can get a group of business leaders to negotiate in a simulation the way young people like to play the game.
So I think dialogue is great, but your comment that nobody's going to do anything about it takes me back to what Steve was saying about the labor question now and back in the 20s and 30s. One thing that's missing now is a lot of labor conflict, a lot of strikes, a lot of disruption. I think there's really no contest that it was crucial to the enactment of the National Labor Relations Act that the country was in somewhat of a labor crisis, turmoil, conflict.
That's right. That's a necessary condition for the moment. But now let me go back to my Wisconsin heritage. Where did the ideas for the National Labor Relations Act, for the Social Security Act, for minimum wages, for unemployment insurance come from? It came from state-level experiments, many of which were in Wisconsin, and it also came from a guy called, nobody in this room will know this, Cindy might, and Jim might, and maybe a few others, a fellow by the name of John R. Commons, who was a professor at the University of Wisconsin. And it was his students who were out there studying all of this stuff, and it was his students who then were the framers of a lot of that legislation in the Roosevelt administration with Francis Perkins. So you need the ideas, you need the local experimentation, and then you need the pressure. Mm-hmm. But you're not going to get it if we get the pressure without building on the tremendous amount of innovation that's already out there and taking those new ideas and bringing them from the local experiments to the national level. Then we'll just try to replicate and we'll get another debate over the Free Choice Act, and it'll, you know, probably go the same way the last one did.
More questions from the audience. Come up to the mics if you want to ask your question.
I have a what I think is a hopefully
and
a very...
You introduce yourself.
Sure, sorry. Ivan Rubin, NYU Law, 1978. I have a substantive question. Professor Kochan, you said that Kaiser Permanente was number two. I was just curious who number one is.
Number two in
the favorite place to work.
I have no idea. I'm not even sure I trust that poll, but... Anyway, it's by some consulting firm that does it. I don't know.
Well, Wegmans Food is up there, though.
Wegmans Food, and Wegmans Food is opening a store down the 2 miles from us. I'm delighted.
But my more substantive question is on the question of public of unions in the public eye. We're about to have unions be in the public eye in this city in a very strong way with, I don't know, is it 150 different contracts that are?
152.
152 that have to be negotiated that have been long sitting there. And I'm wondering what the people on the panel think with respect to how the unions ought to deal with that public eye and how the mayor ought to deal with that public eye. And lastly, in terms of your suggestion, recently I was a judge in the Empire Mock Trial competition, which is a collegiate level competition. And I was thinking, why not set up some hypotheticals and have college students teams, and then you'd get really, without getting, you know, baggage from the past, you might get some new ideas.
Yeah. In New York, since I'm a non-New Yorker, I'll tell you what I'm telling our mayor in Boston, who's facing not quite as big a hurdle, but some of the same ones. It doesn't have the big back pay problem, in fact. And that is, you've got to have a pay for productivity bargain. There's no way that the mayor of New York can make up all those back pay wages and increase wages moving forward at any reasonable level unless you can find a way to sell it to the public and to sell it in a way that we're going to get some efficiencies, some improved quality of service, and we're going to get an engaged workforce. Now, where are those savings going to come from? That's not easy. But AFSCME in this town has generated enormous savings for the city over the years in bringing work back in and showing that the outsourcing is not only a waste of money, but expensive, in some cases corrupt. You've had very similar kinds of things in some areas of school services. I think there's a tremendous opportunity to fundamentally restructure healthcare so that you have more of the kind of Kaiser Permanente and preventive care models, and the unions ought to be the ones who are, and they've got some of those in smaller scale operations, and I think that's an area where there's potentially significant savings. And so it's that kind of thinking that I think mayors around the country, and this mayor is got a lot of good people advising him on this already, have to go. In Boston, and this is not, well, in Boston we have what I'm going to say is sort of private, but not completely.
Not anymore.
We have serious problems with the Boston Public Schools. The Boston Teachers Union has been roundly attacked by the Boston Globe as being very Neanderthal. We're working really hard at the moment with the Boston Teachers Union and with the school department to figure out ways to change that relationship, to drive student improvement, and to extend the day, to expand the day. And we've got all kinds of work going on together, mediating, facilitating, call it whatever you want. But the parties are ready to work together. And I think there'll be a new day in education in Boston. We're doing that across the state in something called the Massachusetts Education Partnership, sponsored by the School Superintendents Association, School Boards Association, the two teacher unions, and some of us who have put it together, Barry Bluestone and myself, a colleague at Northeastern, with funding from the Gates Foundation, and we're working to improve schools through labor management, state-of-the-art collaboration. That's the model for the future, and that's where I think public sector unions have to go in order to demonstrate that they add value to students, to patients, to the public that they serve. And that's the only way I think we are going to see reasonable improvements in wages or benefits for public employees.
Tom, future. I just want to ask you, you said he'd have to show greater productivity links or something to that. Is that because to be able to sell it to the public?
To sell it to the public and to
yes,
pay for
okay.
it.
Right.
He's got, that's a small problem.
The unions are demanding $7 to $8 billion in retroactive pay.
Wow.
The city might have $2 to $3 billion surplus. De Blasio is considered a friend of labor. I think the unions and de Blasio have a lot riding on how they settle this. I think Tom is right that if he gives them $4 billion without getting anything in return, the editorial pages, the business community is going to be all over him. And, you know, I would fully expect that he, as Mayor, former Mayor Bloomberg, will demand some real productivity gains. I think the unions, if they really dig in and demand $4, $5, $6 billion and push the city, you know, towards the fiscal cliff, that's going to really hurt their public image. And I was interviewed today on New York One, and I said, look, you know, if they said, well, instead of taking $4 billion, we'll take $3 billion and use $1 billion of that to fund pre-K, you know, universal pre-K and after school, you know, that would really make unions look as if they're really working for the public interest, but they might not want to do that because that would take the heat off of Cuomo on raising taxes. Yeah.
So was there one more question in the back? Okay.
Fascinating. I had no idea.
And then I want to give each of the panelists a minute or two if you want to wind up.
My name's Nathan. I'm not actually a student here, just here for the panel. I think there are sort of two areas that I'm interested in. One is the really strategic prospects for future organizing, and then the other is a question about legal forms. So even though it's a small percentage of the workforce that's unionized, there's certainly no shortage of low-wage workers and people who would like better labor protections. So for those of you who have thoughts on this matter, what do you think are the best strategic prospects for going out and organizing them? And then can they rely on existing legal forms of unionization and labor protection in terms of meeting those aims, or do they need something new, some sort of, I don't know, economic democracy or a collective control model?
Let me just suggest that that might be an opener for the closing comments that everyone wants to make, but were you here for the keynote address?
No.
Okay, so that would be, get that, Ben. Okay. That's one. It was very much about the menu of options in some ways. But we can, each of the panelists can use their 1 or 2 minutes as they wish, addressing that question or other things that have come up, because we don't have much time left. Thanks.
I'll start very quickly. So I think the AFL-CIO says that, you know, the best route to success is low-wage workers, African-American workers, immigrant workers, and I think Randy would agree that that would be, the best chance. It would be easier to organize workers making $20,000 a year than $100,000 a year. But a big, I was in Chattanooga writing about VW, but I was also interviewing some other workers. I interviewed a low-wage worker at a poultry plant down there, and she's all for the union. She said, African-American woman about 50 years old, she said, but so many of the other workers are just too scared to stick their necks out. So, as Tom said, it's very hard often to get 50%, especially when the company is against you. So I think that's one of the reasons we're seeing this explosion of worker centers. I wrote about this worker center in Texas called the Workers' Defense Project that, has done a very good job helping construction workers in Texas. Construction unions can get wages maybe of $20, $25, $30 an hour. These worker centers, have people sign up. They pay $50 a year. You don't need 50% to join. They have made some gains, maybe creating a wage floor of $11 or $12 on some projects instead of $8. That's a beginning, but their power doesn't begin to compare with the power of a traditional union.
I'm going to take a little different tack, which is in closing comments. I think that these sorts of forms are useful. And Tom, I was thinking about your proposal, but Steve's book's called The Big Squeeze. I can tell you that there are a lot of employers out there, a lot of our members of the chamber, particularly my small business committee, who think they're in the big squeeze. And maybe they're in the big squeeze, they're having a hard time compete for a variety of reasons. The tax code, maybe it's because of over-aggressive zealousness on the part of regulatory agencies. I know personally people who have been driven out of business because of frivolous litigation brought by government agencies. Had him testify on Capitol Hill. They've been friends of mine. So there is another side of this whole story about the competitive pressures employers are under to comply with all the laws they've got to comply with. And I always say, if a small businessman looked at one page of the Code of Federal Regulations, he or she would never open up a business. They have no idea what they're getting into or what is their potential liability when they open a business, and when they can get caught. and sometimes they whistle by the graveyard and hope they don't get caught. So there's tremendous pressures on businesses also. Unions are union, the whole union non-issue is just one slice of that pie. And I would say to my friends on the left, there's never been an acknowledgement of that problem, even when we tried to push very minimal legislation on Capitol Hill that would say if you're a small businessman or woman and you won your case against the National Labor Relations Board, or in this case it was the National Labor Relations Board, and you won your case, you proved you're innocent, the board would have to pay your attorney's fees. It was vehemently opposed by the unions almost as much as when, you know, a much, much higher profile type of labor issue. And I thought it was kind of a no-brainer, an easy one. We got it through the House by one vote. So when we talk about the kinds of things, Tom, you brought up to discuss in a forum, there's another side to all of this. And you know, I tried to hint at that in my opening statement in terms of the benefits employers do provide. I didn't get into the litigation costs they're exposed to. But I could give you a whole presentation. And we're working on a book on this. It's not going to be as long as Steve's, but it's going to be one on crazy cases brought by federal agencies. The EEOC is bringing outrageous cases against employers out there in which they spend millions of dollars on attorney's fees. And the courts are saying, why are you doing this? Why are you spending the resources of a government agency like this going under some crazy legal theory when the facts aren't even there? And by the way, it's so crazy, you better pay the employer $1 million in legal fees. That's taxpayer resources. Instead of going after the kinds of cases Steve recognized in his book, where there's clear wage and hour violations, there's clear discrimination, those are the kind of cases the agencies ought to be going after, instead of wasting these money on these other ones. And again, it's not mine. It's literally the courts coming in and slapping the EEOC down. My only point was, it's not responsive. Your question really was the $64 question. You're kind of saying, well, what's the answer for unions being able to organize in the future? Fortunately, these guys have to answer that. I don't. But there is another part to this whole story that deals with competitive pressures employers are under. It's not IBM and, you know, Microsoft out there. There are lots of businessmen trying to make a living, and women trying to make a living, entrepreneurs. A lot of them are immigrants just trying to get by. And they've got a tough job, too.
I agree. One of them is my son. I have very interesting conversations with him. He started a restaurant and is doing very well, but, you know, has to struggle with all of the things that you mentioned. And I worked with him very closely in all the permitting, which takes a very, very long time. These are real issues. I would just say, let's let the negotiations begin. Let's sit down and talk about those things. But talk about a full agenda, and let's look for more creative solutions, and let's get some of the new voices into it so it's not just the tired old voices, whether it's the AFL-CIO or the Chamber of Commerce or other organizations. They ought to be at the table, but they shouldn't be dominating. There ought to be a dialogue in this country around the future of the economy for the next generation. And we ought to figure out what they need and what they're prepared to do and what they can legitimately expect business, labor, government, education to do to support them. And I think if we open that up for a real discussion and we listen to them, we might actually get somewhere.
Okay, with that, we can end on time. Thank you so much for a great panel.